Members, we have formed a quorum. Let's start our meeting. Item number one on the agenda, confirmation of minutes. Members are invited to confirm the minutes of the special meeting held on the 28th of January 2014. It's paper CB1-1679, stroke 1314. So far, the Secretary has not received any proposed amendments. So can I take it that the minutes can be confirmed? Okay, thank you. Minutes confirmed. Item number two. Well, to save time, please invite the officials to join us now. Item number two, information papers issued since the last meeting. The following papers have been issued since the last meeting. CB1-1647-1340-01, Administration's booklet on general housing policies. And then we have CB1-1563/1314-01 and CP1751/1314-01, and that is the statistics of the land registry for the May and June 2014 provided by the administration. Members, on the 24th of July, we are going to have a special meeting at 9 a.m. It's a public hearing to receive views from deputations on rent, on tenancy control. Please attend the special meeting because we also need a quorum then. I would not like to welcome government officials for attending our meeting. We have Professor Anthony Cheung, Secretary for Transport and Housing, Mr. Stanley Ying, Permanent Secretary for Transport and Housing, Ms. Agnes Wong, Deputy Secretary for Transport and Housing, and Mrs. Vicky Kuo, Principal Assistant Secretary, Housing. Welcome to you all. We're now on item number three, tenancy control. Two papers are relevant. One, CP1-1709/1314-01. And that is a paper provided by the administration on tenancy control. And another paper is LegCo IN18/1314. Information note on tenancy control in selected places prepared by the Research Office of the Legislative Council Secretariat. If members would like to ask questions about the information note, we have Mr. Wu Chi-Hua from the Research Office in attendance to answer members' questions. Now I would like to invite the administration to present the administration's paper on tenancy control. I understand that they are going to use a PowerPoint presentation to give an introduction. Secretary, well, I'll say a few words first. Recently, there have been some discussions about tenancy control. Some of the view that the government should introduce some sort of tenancy control measures in the light of the tight supply of housing so as to further safeguard the interests of tenants, especially those from the grassroots levels. But there are also other people in the community who oppose to this. On the 28th of January and on the 3rd of April at the special FC meeting, I said that the government was looking into this subject of concern. We will look into the history of tenancy control in Hong Kong and relevant experience in overseas countries. Today we have presented a paper to the Council on our research findings and observations. In a moment, my colleagues and Mrs. Vicky Wong will be giving you an introduction. The government adopts a very cautious attitude about introduction of tenancy control measures. We are cautious because we are concerned about the unexpected consequences of such measures. For example, the reduction in housing supply, and also the landlord may raise rent at the very outset. And if this happens, those who want to help would stand to lose instead. And also, according to local overseas experience and findings, such worries are not unfounded. Therefore, we must proceed with a lot of care, and we have to consider carefully the long-term implication for various stakeholders, and also whatever we do, we need to get a consensus first. I'll listen to members' views, and then on the 24th of July, we'll listen to deputations. I understand that the research office of your secretariat has prepared an information paper, a study paper on the subject. We will take that into account in charting our way forward. And I note that there's a tabled statement from Caritas Concern Group covering the views in our document. And my colleague, Mrs. Vicky Kwok, will clarify certain points in a moment about that particular paper. Mrs. Vicky Kwok, Principal Assistant Secretary, Housing. Thank you, Chairman. As the Secretary has said, we are now carrying out a study on tenancy control. We have tried to analyze the subject from various perspectives. The scope of research is to look at the local situation, the latest situation with residential rental market, future housing supply, economic outlook of Hong Kong. And we also look at our past history in tenancy control and overseas experience in this area. We also make reference to the researches conducted by academics and international organizations. We know that there are divergent views on the benefits of a tenancy control system, and there are some unintended consequences. At the same time, we want to also collate views from different quarters. Here, I would like to say something about the Caritas Concern Group concerning Annex E of our paper. In preparing Annex E, we were referring to some reports in the press. We did try our best to make sure that extract that we provided was accurate, and therefore there was checks and confirmation. If you look at Annex E, at first, we had the four words response from Hong Kong Daily News. But then there was a typo. The four words were deleted. Turning to the views expressed by Caritas Grassroots Concern Group, we have already set out their views as support those supporting tenancy control. So it's not an intended editorial mistake. And we thank the Caritas Grassroots Development Concern Project for pointing out the error. And we will also check the origins, and we would give you an updated and amended version so as to set the record straight. Now, let me now turn to the presentation. Well, in our research, we look at information in as practice in various economies. Usually, a tenancy control can achieve some policy objectives. For example, these measures are often used to achieve the objective of addressing the imbalance of information and bargaining power between landlords and tenants. So the policy can be used to address imbalance of information, and it also can reduce eviction and preserve the social linkages among tenants. This is good for social cohesion. And in some economies, it's said that the property market can be stabilized and the inflationary pressure eased.
And also to ensure the provision of affordable housing so that the average citizen can be satisfied in their housing needs. Even though there are a number of such policy targets, There are, however, a number of unintended consequences we have observed. For example, tenancy control, in particular rent control, may reduce the supply of rented accommodation, and as some tenants may not be able to rent flats in the controlled sector, they are forced to seek accommodation in the uncontrolled sector, and hence pushing up the rent level of the latter, as well as investment activities into the housing sector, affecting the developers' pricing and development activities of housing. And given the second factor, and that is the seeking of accommodation in the uncontrolled sector, this may further push up the rent level of the market. Further on unintended consequences, as it will be more difficult for a landlord to terminate a tenancy, some landlords may become more selective about their tenants, and becomes difficult for socially disadvantaged groups to find rental accommodation. And further, to minimize the impact of the control measures, landlords may charge a higher initial rent, ask for more deposit money, demand different kinds of side payments, overcharge tenant on certain payments, for example, water, etc., and alter the lease terms so that it can no longer be classified as lease in law, etc. And there are other areas which may constitute unintended consequences, such as tenancy control tends to discourage the proper maintenance of rented flats by the landlord. And also, overall speaking, in terms of distribution or allocation of resources, there are certain unintended consequences as well which may come up. Under the tenancy control, existing tenants may be discouraged from vacating the premises even if it is in their interest to do so, and this may lead to inefficient allocation of resources and affect interested tenants' mobility to the right sort of housing. We also have noticed views that there are potential benefits to tenancy control. For example, the cases of homelessness will reduce, as it will be more difficult for a landlord to evict his tenant, even if the latter is unable to pay the rent. And also, there are views that security of tenure will incentivize sitting tenants to repair and maintain the premises on their own. And there are certain views maintaining that even though there may be reduced tenant mobility as a result of tenancy control, which would help preserve a close community network, and this will enable the government to provide the necessary community services with precision and continuity, as well as reduce the time and cost for home search and removal for a sitting tenant. And that for identifying a new tenant and refurbishing the premises for re-letting for a landlord. All these will save time and costs. Further, we have looked at studies by the OECD and other areas, and in particular, we would like to share with you a paper published in 2011 by the OECD, which compared a number of housing policies in the 30-odd component countries of the OECD in the areas of housing taxation, land use, rental regulations and social housing policies of its member countries. And it is found that the landlords may initially set higher rents in order to compensate for the erosion of real rents suffered during occupancy, which may actually create and exacerbate the gap between sitting tenants and new tenants in terms of their rental expenditure and access to housing. And further, the OECD found that there is no clear evidence showing a lower average rental in countries with stricter tenancy control measures. Further, from the member countries, they have found that, objectively speaking, where there is a reduction in mobility caused by tenancy control due to a decrease in the supply of rented accommodation, and there may be a lock-in or locking in of tenants. Now, that concludes my introduction. Yes, any supplement to make? Secretary? No, Mr. Chairman. Q&A time, members. 4 minutes to each set of Q&A. Before we go into discussions, I have received from Mr. Wu Chi-wai as a motion and supported by Mr. Li Chuk-yan. We will deal with this motion later on when Mr. Wu's turn comes. Mr. Wu is not in the room right now. This is the queue. Kwok Wai Kung, Leung Kwok Hong, Leung Ka Kit, Li Chuk Yan, and Chong Shu Kan. 4 minutes each, please. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Last month, a group of tenants from Saiwan came to the complaints office of the LegCo with complaints on tenancy control and rental control. They are the weak sector. They belong to the weak sector within the community. They have zero bargaining power, one can say. And when the rental contract or rental agreement comes to term, they will face increment in rentals without any fail. And they can do nothing but to accept what is meted out to them. And where the landlord, through big increases in rentals, are actually, in effect, evicting them. They are going for other tenants, which will be able to pay the rents. And these tenants, sitting tenants, are given a one-month notice, which is impossible for them to find any other accommodation. Apart from high rentals and constant threat of eviction, and at the time of eviction, there is no power to fight back, given that, as Mr. Wu had proposed, the government should, as soon as possible, go about consulting and also changing the tenancy control policies. We believe that this is to be supported because, as we have heard from the government, in terms of rentals and tenancy control, I do not know why they are very loud. But in terms of opposing views, it is much softer. I do not know what the thinking is behind this, but if we look at the 1945 to 1998 rentals policy and the 1973 to 2004 tenancy control, they have been in place for a number of years. The existing policies, which have been criticized left and right, I do not know why they have been in practice for such a long period of time. No one can explain that. They, of course, serve a certain purpose, and I would think, and also they were in befitting of the situation then, for example, when the rentals and also property prices were very, very high, which is exactly what we are facing now. So why do we not adopt the original policies? If we do not, we have to think about how we can protect the tenants and the small, weak members of society. We should think for them and to show that the government cares for them. Now, we have talked about eviction and where the landlord will have sufficient reasons before tenants can be evicted and the one-year protection period to be extended to 2 years. And even if there are rental increases, at least there will be a two-year buffer time, which will help them. 20 seconds left for government's response. Mr. Chair, the government had not on this issue showed any stance as such. We are here to present the findings. Yes, for tenancy control measures if there are other unintended consequences, such as initial rentals, etc. We have to look into that. As mentioned just now, for bargaining power of tenants, that it is weak vis-a-vis the landlords, yes, we have to take that into account as well. Yes, if you want the government to have a full response, would you please be succinct with your question? Mr. Leung Kwok Hong. Yes, whether this bill is outdated, all we have to think, all we have to do is to look at the number of members here. It was 2004 that there was an amendment. Yip Kwok Him, Leung Yu Chong, Lee Chuk Yan were here. Yes, Mr. Rasek was here as well. The chair was not, and not the other members as well. That is to say, the LegCo composition had changed. And why are we holding on to something that's changed? Which government, I ask you, have come to Hong Kong for rental policies, for tenancy policies, and have learned from us? No, none have come to Hong Kong to learn from us. Why? Because they know that with our three highs policy, it is an unnatural and artificial market. And given that, the government, because the market fails, you have no opportunity to come in, Mr. Cheung, Mr. Secretary. The transport is also a problem. The KMB was a problem in terms of its pricing. When you came to the position, you said that you'll be doing something in this regard. What have you done? You said that you'll reduce accidents, but there are more accidents now, traffic-wise. And you said that you lower rentals, but it's not so. It is quite the contrary. I would like to know, Mr. Cheung, have you looked into these issues before? No, you haven't. You just do it nevertheless. Well, actually, it's very simple. Mr. Cheung, Hong Kong's rentals is high and continually high, highest among the world areas and countries. It is a special situation meriting special attention for those people who can afford the rentals or in their disposable income to have 40%, 50%, 60% of that being paid out as rents. That is not true for any other country. Is that the policy objective for those making $20,000 or less for their disposable income? Can you guarantee that they will pay rents for less than 30% of their disposable income? Perhaps they can access public housing. But there is insufficient public housing units to accommodate for all, and as a result, rentals are pumped up. And for purchase of property units, let me ask you, how many landlords really use the rental income to pay for mortgages? $10 million to buy a flat, well, down payment, after paying the down payment, with 5 years of renting out the unit, the person will be able to recuperate the down payment. I mean, can that persist? I mean, if the tenants are evicted, would they have to go live on the streets? What if they die on the streets? I mean, this is all relevant, isn't it? So let me just stop here. Are you in support of, or will you review this?
Secretary, you have a few seconds. Chairman, we did promise to carry out a study which would involve looking to the experience of other economies. That's exactly what we have done, and we have what we have told members today. Okay, I believe you. You have to honor your pledge. Mr. Alan Leung, tenancy control was withdrawn 10 years ago. I dug out the speech of the then secretary, not the current secretary. It was back in 2003, the 11th of February, when the bill was receiving the second reading. The Secretary said that there must be an effective safety net so that people who would not be able to afford to rent would not be rendered helpless because of the cancellation of the tenancy control. So it was back in 2003, the 11th of or the 6th of November, or rather the 11th of June. 11 years have passed, and now we have people who find it difficult to rent. Back then, the secretary gave us this promise. So the administration should look at what has been the case with rental accommodation in the past 11 years. If the safety net has proved to be ineffective in helping the grassroots in securing rental accommodation, perhaps you should face up to the problem. So I hope the Secretary can promise us today that a review can be conducted. What to do after that is another matter. Well, I have contacted people who are facing real housing problems and also organizations representing these people. They are not asking for the reinstatement of the pre-2003 tenancy control. It's not really meaningful to do this for the luxurious residential properties. And of course, certainly, if we do this, it's not helpful. So I want to ask if there will be a review conducted by the administration. And then after that, would the administration be willing to take a targeted measure to target certain segments of the market? Because the safety net has been found to be ineffective. For example, if we look at the rateable values of certain properties, you would mandate that the notice to be given will no longer be 1 month, but 3 or 4 months. Secretary, I very much understand why some people would like to reintroduce tenancy control of some sort and why they want to do this. For example, high rental and the inequality in the bargaining power of tenants vis-a-vis landlords, as we have set out in the study. Some countries do impose tenancy control. Some would target properties completed before a certain date, and also the problems that such a system may create. For example, the reduction of housing supply, the rise in initial rent, and building management, building maintenance is reduced as a result. If the supply is insufficient, then all such measures will backfire. We mustn't lose sight of that. Mr. Liu, Mr. Li Chuk-yan, the impression I gain from this document is the same as those you mentioned when we talk about minimum wage. You keep talk about the negative side so that we don't have to do this. Of course, there are always pros and cons, but I do see the inclination of your stance, and that is you devote a lot of space to negative effects. With tenancy control, you have fewer landlords who are willing to let their property, and for the first tenancy agreement, they would push up the initial rent. Well, frankly speaking, this is happening. In the private rental market, the rent is already at an exorbitantly excessive level. On a per square foot basis, subdivided units can demand higher rents than luxurious apartments, and the tenants get only the 1 year of a secured tenancy, and then they have to move because of the higher rental asked by the landlord. There are positive benefits for a tenancy control. This would address rental increase and also the imbalance of bargaining power. And then after setting out the benefits, you'd turn to the negative impacts. If that will result in reduction of housing supply, you may also consider introducing a tax on vacant properties. And also we should consider conferring the tenancy the protection. And that is to say the landlord is allowed to increase rent, but there should be a suitable notification period, and a reasonable notice should be served. So what is your direction for the future? You have conducted the study. Are you going to conduct a public consultation exercise? What's the timetable? And what is your inclination? If you're inclined to introduce such measures, then we can discuss how best to go about it. So the question is, what's your inclination? And second question, do you have a timetable on a review on rent control? Well, in the consultation process, we have had the benefit of divergent views, as set out in the paper. The member is concerned whether we are going to just stress the negative side of tenancy control, but no, we are going to set out both sides of the story. And if you look at the unintended consequences and the side effects of rent tenancy control, there are many studies which refer to this. And I have this report from OECD covering all the economies, including those who have rent control measures, such as Germany. Please use some time to go over this report, and then you know that we are not trying to present just one side of the picture. If we were to introduce tenancy control measures, and then because of the time supply, the rent is pushed up very quickly, then is it the best way to help those tenants that we want to help? What's your inclination? My question has not been answered. Well, if you are inclined to do something, then we can discuss how to do it. Do you have any inclination, Secretary? Well, we do have concerns about tenancy control as set out in the paper. At this meeting and in the previous public hearing, we have listened to views. And then we will set out our response to such views expressed through various channels in our paper on long-term housing strategy to be issued later. Mr. Christopher Jones, in the paper, he said that there are tenants living in private properties who are waiting to be allocated PRH flats, and the long-term solution would be to give them the PRH flats. But we all know that the waiting time of 3 years exceeds in name only. Well, we have encountered cases whereby the waiting time has been 4 years or more. Would the administration be willing to help those families waiting to be allocated PRH units for more than 3 years by providing a rent allowance? Secretary, well, we responded to this question already. when the supply is tight in the market, then objectively speaking, providing a rent allowance by the government would just encourage the landlord to increase rent. So the allowance would go to the landlord instead of the tenant. So we have to be very careful about doing things like this. But the fact is, the rent used to be $3,000, now it's $4,000-$5,000. And these people earn just a low salary, otherwise they won't be eligible for PRH. So on the one hand, rent is increasing, on the other hand, you don't help them. Do you expect them to sleep on the street? As regards Mr. Chung's questions, I think they illustrate that this is not just a simple problem requiring a simple and straightforward solution. Ultimately, if the supply cannot be increased, whether in the public or in the private sector, then rent would never be able to come down. And that's why in the long-term housing strategy, we believe that the solution, the ultimate solution, lies in increasing supply. Well, we are not in a lecture and you're not a professor. We are looking at real-life issues here. You cannot increase the supply. And the administration has the duty to safeguard people's right to have a roof over their head. I ask you for an allowance, and you're saying that this will only benefit the landlord. So have you considered ways and means that some assistance can be provided to the poor without allowing the landlord to get a big chunk out of it? It's your responsibility. Well, it's not an academic speculation that I was talking about. It's the experience of many economies. If you provide a rent allowance in a tight market, then you may think that you are getting a higher income in the form of a subsidy, but the rent will go up further. Mr. Chung asked what can be done if we want to avoid that consequence. That's why we are having reservations. Mr. Yip Kwok Kim? We in the DAB have reservations about tenancy control. Mr. Leung Kok Hong talked about the 2003 exercise. We passed a bill to cancel the tenancy control system at that time. DAB voted in favor of that. If we want to provide housing to the grassroots, well, it's the responsibility of the government. And this is not a responsibility of private property owners, especially the owners who just owned a small flat. And these landlords relied on rent for an income. And then there were so-called rogue tenants there. And there are problems with building maintenance. If we have tenancy control, we mustn't ignore these negative issues. The problems we have are mostly found in the old districts and or newly developed districts. The important thing is to increase housing supply. The government should work hard to increase housing supply so that the rent is subject to the market forces. so that we can avoid excessive rental increases. I think members in this council should give careful thought to various options, as you can find in the information note prepared by our secretariat. There aren't many countries near Hong Kong which practice rent or tenancy control. Has the administration ascertained the trend with other countries? Are they moving from having tenancy control towards not having it, or the other way round?
Given the limited time, I'll not be able to give a very full answer, but if you look at Appendix C of our paper, you will see the practice of different countries, Asian countries, Taiwan, Japan, Singapore, Malaysia, as well as US and other countries. And you can see for Taiwan, even though there are certain rental controls, but it is only at the initial setting of the rentals to set the cap, and it is set at 10% of the value of the property. That's about it in terms of control that they have. That is about the only one in the neighboring countries. As for the European countries, such as Germany, there are rental controls, but they are on different standards. For example, in setting the initial rental, or in rental increase, or in different methods and manners. And in the document, you're able to see the positive and negative consequences are also listed out. Now, your time is up for your question. There are still a number of members waiting to speak, and we also have another controversial item on our agenda. I will now ask Mr. Leung Yew Chung. 4 minutes. Now, 10% increase in rentals for the HA, and I'm sure the private sector would also increase rentals by more than 10%, and that will be $400, $500 for a small unit. And this is unsustainable for the average person in Hong Kong, Mr. Secretary. You have to help them, and you're not able to help them by doing what you are proposing to do here. You have listed the positive and negative consequences, but have you thought about the Hong Kong idiosyncrasies or situation? We have a number of other relevant factors. Have you considered them? For example, a lot of people are worried about the rental control. What are people worried about? They're worried about maintenance, they're worried about vacant flats, but is that something that cannot be solved? For example, for older buildings, it used to be that there were no mandatory maintenance to be carried out. There were no mandatory examination of their windows or window frames. But that's all changed now. So there are solutions. And I think you are being insincere here. If you are sincere, you would be looking for solutions to the issues and problems that you have named just now. On service, you seem to be very fair. You list out the pros and the cons, but that's superficial work. It does not solve the problems. You have to tell us upfront the tenants, the problems that tenants are facing, the tenancy contracts, the rentals. How do you solve their plight? Mr. Secretary, I have the question for you. Are you thinking about the other measures as well, apart from rental controls, so as to make this effective? Well, Mr. Chairman, I thought today's agenda was really about a sharing of the findings of our study, and that is how we envisaged this particular agenda item. But members are now asking me how I am coming up the IM to come up with the solutions. Well, I'm willing to listen to your views. And I also say that there are a number of overseas examples that we have to refer to. And in Hong Kong, there may be certain unforeseen consequences to certain policies, but we definitely can learn from the experience of other countries. Mr. Chairman, if we look at the previous years and examples and experience, even though they may not be exactly the same as what we're facing now, but we were able to put them into practice, why can't we look at those examples and come up with hypothetical situations and say, under these circumstances, this would be the solution, under that circumstance, another solution. But rather, you're saying you're looking at overseas examples, and you're saying that there are a number of consequences, but that's like saying that the mother is a woman. That's neither here nor there. If you have to be more positive, you have to look at the issue squarely rather than to be a commentator, a spectator. You are the secretary, not a spectator or bystander here. Phung Kim Kay? Yes. Mr. Secretary said rental subsidy is no good and rental control is no good. Perhaps the secretary is saying that there should be more housing supply, and that everybody knows, but it will take time before the buildings can be built, for the foundation to be done, for the piling, etc. would take 4 to 6 years at least. 15,000 units, Mr. Leung, the CE, had raised that to 22,000, and you're talking about 47,000. It still falls short of your target of 47,000 units. But what do we do in the interim? Do we stand still? Is there nothing we can do from now till then? Mr. Chairman, we have emphasized time and again before that in order to solve this problem of rentals, at the end of the day, the solution lies in supply. Social housing is a rent control measure as well, and that's practiced in some other countries as well. In the private market, if the rentals are to be controlled and not to be raised significantly, there will have to be a supply and demand equilibrium or near equilibrium, rather than for artificial intervention into the market. In the past, in Hong Kong also, yes, the government had to step in. But in this study, as I have mentioned just now, I thought today's meeting was about delivering the study from the government, because that was the wish of this meeting, of this panel, for the government to do a study. And we have done so. And we are delivering it here. But of course, for any control measures, we have to look at the nature of the measure itself or the control itself with its different consequences depending on the content of the control. But we have to understand that there will be unintended consequences for any control policy. Mr. Chairman, you have a paper on the history of rental controls in Hong Kong in the past years. You have just laid out the facts without, the policies, without telling us the consequences. You have talked about the different eras and the up to the present time where there are no controls, but you are silent on why the policies were put into place and what the consequences are after the policies have been put into place. So I cannot see from the paper what the Hong Kong situation was holistically, whether it is the same or similar with some overseas experience. I do not know. Is there room for further information provision? Now, I mentioned 4 to 6 years being the lead time for further units to be supplied. So does it mean that within the era of CY loan that nothing can be done? Is it a standstill? Mr. Chairman, concerning Appendix D on the history of Hong Kong, we have mentioned 1981. That is the review committee's analysis, observations, and proposed ways forward. And in different times and eras, different solutions were designed according to the situation at the time in society, economics, rental situation, etc. So, and they are not all the same. And at present, are we saying that we have a standstill? Certainly not. We will be trying our best. We are looking very closely at the market rentals, the trend of that. And we have mentioned in our paper that for rentals and also property prices, they have leveled somewhat. But of course, there are a lot of voices in society asking whether they are still too high, and we have to respond to those voices as well. Members, would you please limit? Would we please limit ourselves to 4 minutes? But if the secretary is still speaking, then I will allow him to complete his sentence. Now, Mr. Wu has a motion. Wu Chi-wai. There will not be a second round because we do have other agenda items. We still have a queue for first round. Actually, the first person, Mr. Wu, is to speak. No, actually, Mr. Cheng should speak first. I'm sorry. So you're first on the queue. Mr. Cheng Chiu-hong, please. I'm sorry. Cheng Chiu-hong should speak first. Ask your question, please. Mr. Chairman, the Secretary mentioned that in order to solve the problems of high rentals and unacceptable living conditions, he said the solution is in supply and demand. But look at the past 10 years without rental control. Has supply increased or decreased? It is very clear to see that it had decreased rather than increased in 2003. Private housing units was 26,000 units. Last year, 2013, our private housing units was 8,300. You say cancelling rentals control would increase supply. That simply does not stand, as we can see. So what is actually true, what is very clear for all to see, is that in the past 10 years, without the control, supply had been dwindling, falling. And now you're saying that's not true. You have been asked a question just now by our members saying subdivided flats are a big problem. And from 2009 to 2014, there had been 63% increase in rentals for private housing. As for 400 square feet or 40 square meter size or below, the rental increase had been some 70% in that period, 2009 to 2014. So this is completely way over what is the trend. Now, if you also say that if there should be housing subsidies, the landlords would benefit or pocket it all. But on the other hand, rental control is not desirable. So you're trying to do neither. You point to supply, but supply is limited, and it will be a long wait before there can be more supply. And now people are living right now in subdivided flats in terrible living conditions. And we're talking about hundreds of thousands of people in Hong Kong.
And it is policy 21 appointed by yourself and other research organizations, saying that they are paying over 30% of their disposable income as rentals for these subdivided flats. So what are you doing, what will you be doing to alleviate this kind of pressure? Well, Mr. Cheung had spoken about the burden for grassroots and also for subdivided flat tenants. This is a very real issue, and we understand the issue. But it doesn't mean that we do not take into account the consequences. If we put into practice the rental controls, I have not said that with the cancellation of rental controls, there will be a lot more supply. There would be, there are definitely reasons for any country in practicing rental controls, and maybe more supply will be released. But on the other hand, was there sufficient land provided by the government to build the buildings, whether private or public, and whether there's sufficient motivation in the market to build those buildings? So for other countries' experience, including countries with installation of rental controls, it is true that there can be a lowering of supply. Well, Mr. Chairman, I don't think he's given us an answer or solution. Yes, we will have another meeting. You can pursue that at the meeting. Now we go to Wu Jiwei. For rental control, there had been a big review as made by the government, and after that there's been a number of policies and protections.
Well, if we have such a system, tenants are getting some protection. Rent increase cannot be limitless. We're not asking that there should be no rent increase, just that it can be increased by no more than 30% in 2 years. To some extent, such a measure would enable a tenancy agreement reach between the tenant and the landlord. That would afford tenancy protection and allow rental increase as well. Back then, there was the concern of rogue tenants, and then it was felt that the matter should be left to the market, and so the tenancy control system was cancelled. Nothing we can do about it now, but we'd like you to come up with a new timetable to review control measures on tenancy control, tenancy protection. A review will provide a platform for all parties to be involved in the discussion. And this process may take 3 to 5 years. But according to the administration, the supply will be improved significantly vis-a-vis what we see now in 3 years' time. And I think the landlord would like to see a contractual arrangement that would give them some certainty about rental increase. And on that basis, we can reach a consensus whereby tenancy security can be afforded and rental increase can be allowed. And that would be in line with the market development. Can that be done? Secretary, as the member has pointed out, if we are to introduce some sort of tenancy control, we need to amend the law. It's not a straightforward matter. And there are divergent views. So it's not really straightforward to have legislative amendments passed. But that's not the most important consideration. If in other economies, they see problems, they've experienced problems associated with tenancy control, how can we deal with those negative issues? We can't just ignore them or pretend that they don't exist. And many members have asked me what I can do failing a tenancy control. That's precisely the problem we have. That's why I want your timetable. Well, your motion will be put to the vote, so please move it when it's time to do so. Dr. Kwoka K. We know that the rental property market is not functioning. You can blame the previous administration, and that's why we have so many homeless people. It's because of the past policies. Those who are subject to the biggest impact are the tenants of subdivided flats. Secretary, you have talked about the solutions, increasing PLH, increasing the supply in the private market, but simply not done. Even if you try to catch up, you will not be able to return us to the 2003 levels. And it's laughable, if not a shame, that we have seen such exorbitant rental increases. And you are not able to increase the supply of PRH very quickly. And if you are not going to introduce tenancy control, then you might as well admit that there's nothing you can do to help them. Of course, it's difficult to decide which rental level is the appropriate one. But the tenants are asking for the protection against eviction and the short notice period required. They have no security. The landlord can just give a short notice, and then the tenant will have to seek another accommodation, paying $2,000, $3,000, or $4,000. It may be just as a drop in the bucket if you have if they have the income like yours, but it's a lot to them. So what can you do to help these people who are facing housing difficulties? What can you do? Secretary, if I were to say that we are going to introduce tenancy control, then, as we have seen in other countries, rent will go up immediately. Are we going to help those tenants? I cannot avoid this issue. We have pointed out precisely the consideration in countries with or without tenancy control. We cannot act on impulse in introducing a policy. Very often, a policy carries a price. It's not painless. It's not a painless choice. But what about Annex C, the notification period for terminating the tenancy? And can something be done? It's got nothing to do with rent. And also for subdivided flats or 200, 300 square feet, can something be done under the law to help them in respect of notification required, not rent? Secretary, actually here today, we are We have presented the findings of our study, and of course we listen to views expressed by members, and I have to admit that such views have been expressed previously. When would they come up with a mature policy? Well, actually, the Secretary has indicated that towards the end, under the long-term housing strategy, the arrangement, they would tell us something. Mr. Michael Tin? Well, I took part in an RTHK docudrama in 2012. I lived in a unit 3 feet by 7 feet, 21 square feet that is. The rent was $1,300. And to prepare for today's meeting, I asked those who arranged for that flat for me a few days ago about the rental that the same unit would fetch. And I was told that it's $1,900 now. So it's an increase from $1,300 to $1,900. And I don't think the income of the tenant would go up by 50% in the same period, although we didn't have minimum wage at that time. New People's Party has had a very fierce debate among our members. And the basic conclusion is that however well-intended a policy might be, the devil is always in the detail, and that is whether the policy can be implemented. If you launch a full-scale tenancy control, it's likely that you would distort the market. But that's not the consensus of the community, of course, because people don't want to regulate the luxury market. So if you were to do something about targeted tenancy agreements, you may have to draw a line according to the size of the flat. And I talked to some grassroots people. Very oddly, some of them just thought that we might be doing something bad unintentionally. If you draw the line along at a certain size, then the supply may just dry up. Or you may draw a line based on the rent, say $2,000 or $3,000, and then the landlord will suddenly increase the rent. And you may say that there's no taker and the rent will come down. But there's community pressure to help these people to pay the rent which they cannot afford. And then the government may be forced to provide a subsidy, and that money will go to the landlord. Would that be what we'll see if you draw a line like that? If you look at New York, San Francisco, Massachusetts, has any one of them been able to draw a line without distorting the market? Can you explain why some of the flats are now taken up by high-income earners instead of low-income earners? Well, in some U.S. cities, they have comprehensive tenancy control measures, and people who are not supposed to need the protection are getting the protection, which is not intended to be afforded to these people. Whether you refer to size or rent, there are always means to bypass the regulation. If part of the market is regulated and the other part is unregulated, then the tenants are subject to the very different treatment according to the experience of other countries. they think this is going to be problematic. Mr. Wong Yuk-man, Chairman, if you look at this research report from the administration and the literature that they have referred to, well, it's not very objective. They are not very objective. Why do you just refer to overseas experience? Is it that we never had any study on tenancy control? And we are very different from other countries in terms of the overall environment and the economy. In other countries, they have comprehensive social security programs. So I think the value of such overseas experience is indeed very low. The fact that we have to discuss whether there is any basis to introduce tenancy control reflects the relationship between the executive and the legislature. Well, back then, we had tenancy control, but then it was cancelled more than 10 years ago. It's not a monster. Yes, there were defects, shortcomings with the tenancy control system we had back then. There was a lot of discussion. The inflation was much higher than what we saw in the past 10 years, and there was no pledge to the allocate PRH flats to the waiting list applicants in within 3 years. So you should look into those instances and experience. You're just putting up excuses that in the private market, competition is fierce. There's no monopoly. Flats are owned by individual landlords, and there's no need to introduce tenancy control. You've ignored that the supply is so low. There were only 8,000 flats per year. It was one quarter of what we had from 1989 to 2004. We have 23,000. Rents went up by 54%. If it's under 40 square meters, the increase was 60%, much higher than inflation. That's all because of the low supply and the imbalance of demand and supply.
Of course, the government would say rental control would bring on a lot of negative consequences. We'll not go into all that here now. I just want to discuss this with you, Mr. Secretary. And the rights of the tenants, will they be able to, after paying market rentals, that they will have the right to continue to rent the units? If that is not to be the case, would the government be able to subsidize the balance? And by so doing, the households will be able to apply for a capped square meterage and also a particular capped rental. And at the same time, the government is to provide more supply of land for housing, both private and public, so as to increase the supply and to effectively lower the rentals. But I'm sure you will not be instituting rental controls. I know that even if I put a gun to your head, this study of yours is really just to placate us. I know that 100% or 1,000%, I know it to be true, that you will not put it into practice, that is, rental control policy. So perhaps rental subsidies is something that you can think about. Well, your time is up, Mr. Wong. Sorry about that. Mr. Leung Chee Chong? Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a different thinking from Mr. Wong. At least we can perhaps discuss this. At least we have this paper in front of us done by the government, this study. At least we have more information to study and refer to. Indeed, there is a shortage of housing units. And the result is inevitable. That is, rentals are exorbitantly high. And the government is saying that come up with more supply of housing, and for the so that the grassroots will not be adversely affected. But we all understand that for the government to do so would take another 10 years before the 45,000 units target can be reached, and in these, or 450,000 units. In these 10 years, Mr. Secretary, you can only make some additions every year, but the overall situation is not improved right away. Apart from this way of solving the problem, are there any other ways? I mean, we notice in the market that rentals are increasing by 2 times, 3 times, and it's completely rampant and uncontrolled, meaning the market has run away. I would like to know whether there are solutions. I am not in total support of rental control, on the other hand. I would like to ask Mr. Secretary what solutions you have to help everybody. The Poor Relief Committee are trying to help the households with difficulty, but the households that they can help would be very few. This is not a blanket policy. And for rental control, it would be the landlord helping these needy households, because the landlords are making less. But that is still a distortion, even though the households are helped. So the government seems to have stalemated. You're worried that the rental control is a monster. It is not to be let out. But on the other hand, there are no other solutions. Everybody's scolding you. What other solutions do you have apart from rental control? If you say rental control is not desirable, what comeback do you have? I mean, there's got to be a solution, but the government does not have one. It does not have a plan. So even for us who want to support the government, we can't, because you have come up with nothing. But of course, rental control may lead to different opinions from society, and society have a lot of different views, as we can see nowadays. The academics have come up with their points of view, for instance, but can we have a mid-ground, something that's practicable? Let's say, for instance, the rental increase, the magnitude of rental increase, perhaps we control that. And according to our present legislation, for tenants which refuse to leave the flats, there are means against them. So this shouldn't be a problem. Mr. Secretary, can you come up with some interim measures as solutions so that in the coming 10 years from now till then, we can have some intermediate solutions for control? No time for response. 4 minutes up. Mr. Fang Gong, please. Mr. Secretary, you have mentioned time and again it's about supply. Well, public housing, there's insufficient land. Rental, the number of rental housing is insufficient. So at the end of the day, it is about supply. That is a problem. And supply is not something that you can resolve in a day or two. I have a bold suggestion to make. Perhaps my colleagues in the Legco would think that I've gone mad. But I would think that, Mr. Secretary, you really have to think about legalizing subdivided flats. Before you can come up with the sufficient supply, how are you able to satisfy the market? The only thing you can do is to legalize subdivided flats. Well, in the past, our society in Hong Kong have had subdivided flats, you know, boarded rooms, if you will. Yes, indeed, living standards have been raised, but now we have a shortfall of property, shortfall of housing. And in this period, can we perhaps consider legalizing subdivided flats? At least this is a safe area. And also, can the government come up with a reasonable rental? Yes, this is a rental that is suggested by the government. It is not mandatory. That's another possibility. And further, at the point of making the rental agreement, perhaps the agreement, the tenure can be longer, let's say for shopping units as well, shop fronts as well, let's say it can be lengthened to 3 years. And at the time of coming to maturity, a six-month notice period is to be enshrined so that there is sufficient time for the tenant to look for other housing. So this is not about rental policy as such, but at least there will be certain guidelines for people to follow. Mr. Secretary, please. Mr. Chairman, while I answer Mr. Fong Kong's question, I would also want to respond to the previous members in their questions. Well, I think we are caught between the devil and the deep blue sea. Indeed, at the end of the day, it is about supply in housing, both private and public. But we all know that that takes time, more supply. And in finding land is not something that's very straightforward in Hong Kong these days. And a number of members have talked about rental controls, either partial or total, and about tenancy rights, etc. Basically, it's about from now till then, that is by the time we can provide the supply, whether there can be some interim solutions to lower the level of pain. I can tell you in our study, it has revealed that other countries have a number of other measures in terms of maintenance, rentals, and consequences for tenants, etc. Now, today, we will not have a conclusion to this discussion here. We will have a deputation, and whether we have a consensus in society as yet, well, I think there will be more views and opinions being raised in society, and the government will open the ears and listen to all of them. But for any measure that we consider, we have to look at possible consequences, and we have to balance all the pros and cons thus engendered. Yes. I will now speak as an individual LegCo member. Mr. Wu, you will have your turn. Don't leave yet. I personally think with the abolition of rental control policy, well, it's been 10 years now, as mentioned just now, it is ripe for a review. And this review should take into consideration the rights of the landlord as well as the tenant and how we can strike a balance between the two. For rentals, adjustments, for tenancy duration, for protection of rights of tenancy, and also for protection of the rights of landlords, I think there should be a balance and there should be consideration of all these. And from that, find an optimum point and a reasonable way. The abolition of rental controls 10 years ago, at the time, it was overdone in the sense that the abolition at the time was because of a number of pressures and issues and opinions. That was the reality then. But with the abolition, the problem had been complicated, and there are a number of phenomena emerging, and we have talked about them just now. And I noticed that a number of my colleagues have talked about the review, whether the review can be more focused. And on this point, I think at this stage, the government really should look into this to see whether the government can do so. Now, because there is insufficient supply in public housing, far lagging behind demand, then therefore the grassroots in Hong Kong are faced with very, very grave housing problems. Now, without rental controls everybody is facing hikes in rental levels, and also in a very short period of time, the tenants are to be out to vacate the flats, and there is insufficient time for the tenants to look for new accommodation. With this kind of situation, I would think, as a responsible government, it cannot turn a blind eye. Who will address these difficulties if not the government? So I would think for the government to be responsible at all, it should look squarely in the face the difficulties that the grassroots of Hong Kong are facing. In the next 10 years, yes, there will be additional public housing units to be provided by the government, but really we're talking about dire imbalance of supply and demand right now. What about the short term?
For those who are caught in such housing problems, the government should look for ways and means to help them. Although we know that there may be unintended consequences for introducing tenancy control, but there's no reason for not doing some studies to find feasible solutions. That's all I want to say. I hope the Secretary would consider my suggestions. That's all for my time to speak as a member of the panel. It's for time for Mr. Wu Chi-wai to move his motion. And that is the housing panel of this council requests that there should be a public consultation exercise to be launched expeditiously on tenancy control, and there should be a review timetable on tenancy control set by the administration. For those in favor, please raise your hands. 7. Those against? Any objection? 1. Abstentions? 1. So the motion is carried. 7 in favor, 1 against, 1 abstention. So that wraps up this particular part of the agenda. The next item 4, third rent review for public rental housing, paper number CP1-1742/1314-1. Administration's paper on third rent review for public rental housing. Another paper is CP1-1742/1314-02. Updated background brief on rent adjustment mechanism for public rental housing prepared by the Legislative Council Secretariat. And also CP1-1752/1314-01. A motion to be moved by Ms. Alice Mack. For this item, I'd like to welcome the following officials. The three in the front row will stay behind, and in the back row, we have Mr. Anson Lai, Assistant Director, Strategic Planning from the Housing Department. And Mr. Leslie Tang from the CNS Department, Commissioner for Census and Statistics, and Mr. Kenneth Lam, Senior Statistician from CNS Department. Over to the Secretary for a brief introduction, please. The Housing Department was amended in 2007 to set a public rental review and adjustment. There was a newly enacted Section 16A, depending on these factors, there will be a two-year cycle in reviewing public rental, and it's capped at 10%. There's no floor in terms of the lowest adjustment rate. It will look at the affordability of tenants and at the same time take into account the sustainability of the housing authority in taking forth public rental housing development. There have been two exercises. The first one in 2010, looking at the income index from 2007 to 2009, the rate was 4.68%. So there was an increase in rent by 4.68%. The second exercise was conducted in 2011, looking at the change from 2009 to 2011. The rate was 16.24% in terms of income, so the rental increase was 10%. This time is the third exercise, and that is we look at the period from 2011 to 2013. It has now been completed. According to the report from the Commissioner for Census and Statistics, the income has gone up by the 19.27%. On the 4th of July, the Housing Authority had a meeting and accepted the report from the Commissioner for Census and Statistics, and it has been resolved that the rent, public rent for public rental housing estate should go up by 10%, effective the 1st of September. Some members are concerned whether the rental increase would add to the burden, heavy burden of the PRH tenants. Some other members are of the view that the HA is not in a very good financial position, and there would be no need for an across-the-board waiver. Instead of across-the-board waiver, HA should provide assistance to target groups. Some members are of the view that the rent assistance scheme should be strengthened, and also to look at ways to improve the assistance schemes. The department has agreed to look into this. And now I would like to ask my colleague, Mr. Anson Lai, to brief you with the help of an PowerPoint presentation. Thank you. Mr. Lai, let me talk about the background. Housing Ordinance Cap 283 contains a section 16A, on how to adjust rental or public PRH, and some of the factors are relevant. The income would reflect their affordability. This mechanism provides an objective basis on how and when to adjust PRH rents so as to maintain the long-term sustainability of the PRH program. Simply put, there will be a review every 2 years, and the HA will look into the change in income levels from the first and second period to decide whether the rent should be increased. The HA would select 2,000 households for the income declaration, and making a return is compulsory. And also for the first and second period, 24,000 tenants will also be selected to reflect the income change situation. If the income index in the second period is 0.1% more than this first period, then the HA would increase rent by 10%. If the second period index is lower by the first period index by 0.1%, then there should be a corresponding reduction. There's no lower limit on that. This is the third exercise, and the HA selected random sample households for the income declaration to ensure the accuracy and representativeness and authenticity. We have taken on board the views expressed by CNS department in sampling and collation of data, and the department will also carry out the quality assurance arrange checks on the sampling and statistics collection. And we look at distribution of income levels in selecting the households is done through a random sampling exercise. Depending on the distribution of PRHS days and also the talents income levels. So the samples is representative. So we have covered talents within the normal income range. So we would take away those who are considered non-representative talents to ensure that there will be no distortion. Here we talk about the well-off tenants because their income levels are higher than ordinary PRH tenants. That's why they are called well-off tenants. And also those who have high income levels, who are not common tenants, because income declaration is required after you have moved in for 10 years, and those who have high incomes but have not moved in for 10 years will be excluded. We also exclude the CSSA recipients because their rent is paid by the security, social security programs. Here we have a sample of 5,500 tenants. We excluded in 2011 5,500 CSSA recipients, and also in 2013 we excluded 5,000 CSSA households. The CNS department think that the final sample tenants can provide a very sound basis for compiling the income index. Let me also talk about the quality checks. If we discover problems with the income declaration, we can send our officers to the pay home visits so as to advise them how to fill the problems. And if some of the forms are not properly filled out, we also take follow-up action. And then we would input the data into our computer system to ensure accuracy, that we'll have two separate teams of officers to input the same information and compare the two sets of data to see if there's any discrepancy. We also check consistency through computer software. And if there is any inconsistency, we would clarify with the tenant. The Census and Statistics Department also carry out their audit quality checks. They will verify the distribution of household size and distribution of BLH. And the result shows that the sample is representative, both in terms of distribution and household size. And also from those who have submitted income declarations, we would randomly select 5% for clarification and validation. And the results show that no tenant has willfully make false representations, and there's no substantial or material discrepancy between the declared data and the final results. The CNS department is of the view that the survey has been effective in showing the change in income levels. According to the survey, in 2011, the average household income of PRH tenants was $15,473. So the index for that period was 100. For 2013, the same income, median average income was 18%, 455. So the index was 119.27. So that's the index went up by 19.27%. Because the index went up by 19.27% from the first period to the second period, so the PRH rental adjustment was It was 10% effective the 1st of September 2014. So the average rent is $1,540. if we increase it by 10%, then the increase will be from $28 to $387, the average being $154. This is the table showing the number of PLH tenants who are going to be affected by the relevant rental increase brackets. The housing authority considered the CNS report on the 4th of July and endorsed the findings of the third rental reviewed and resolved to increase PLH rent by 10% to be effective the 1st of September 2014. The tenants will be given 1 month's notice for the increase. The HA has noted that in the past 2 years, average income of PRH tenants increased by 19.27% from $15,473 to $18,455. Rental increase, the average rental increase was from $28 to $387. So the income has gone up to a far greater extent the rent increase. Based on the design of the rent adjustment mechanism from 2009 to 2011, income went up by 16.24%, rent by just 10%, and from the period for between 2011 and 2013, income went up by 19.27% and rent will only go up by 10%.
Based on our data as at the end of December 2013, 33% of tenants are well-off tenants and should be able to afford the rent increase. Another 19% are CSSA recipients. And basically, they rely on CSSA receipts to pay for the rents, and therefore the impact on them would also be low. In addition, 2% of our tenants are facing temporary financial difficulties currently receiving rental assistance under our RAS, so they will not be greatly impacted. And between the first and second round of reviews, because of special circumstances, there were a 1 month rent waiver. And for this particular round, does the HA have the grounds to provide that kind of rent waiver? That is open to questions. Apart from the factors that I've mentioned just now, the committee of the HA had also noticed that in the January budget, then the impact on the budget for 2014 to 15, according to the budget, the rental housing operating deficit was 1.7 billion. If there is an increase by 10% in rentals, this will be decreased to 0.9 billion. And if we have 1 month waiver, the sum would actually increase from 0.9 billion to 2.1 billion, and that would actually be a 400 million increase from the original scenario. And we have also noticed that for Bracket 4 of the section of the Housing Ordinance actually stipulates that the policy of the HA shall be directed to ensuring the revenue accruing to it from its estate shall be sufficient to meet its recurrent expenditure on its estates. So granting a rent waiver to all tenants, irrespective of whether tenants are in need, may not be the best use of HA's revenue. It may also not be the most equitable. And also we know that there is growing demand for HA's resources from citizens waiting for PRH units. Instead, we believe the HAC considered there should be targeted assistance to those tenants who are really in need, such as by enhancing the RAS. Members invited to note the outcome of the third rent review exercise in accordance with the Housing Ordinance, and we welcome questions from you. The queue is as follows: Mark Mei Kun, Leung Yu Chung, Leung Chi Chang, Lee Chak Yan, Fong Kim K, Fong Kong. Anybody else, members? Leung Ka Kit, Kwok Wai Kong. Four minutes each, Q plus A. Ms. Back. Mr. Chair, first of all, The Federation of Workers believe that we have reiterated many times that in this rentals increase mechanism, it is not comprehensive. In particular, there is no inflation consideration. And in fact, you can imagine for citizens of Hong Kong, even though there may be an increase in salaries given the high inflation rate currently, in fact, the standard of living is falling. That is to say, salaries increase does not match up to inflation rates increase. So if we only look at household income to set the rentals, it is incomprehensive, and therefore this mechanism should be reviewed in this light. With this kind of rentals increase, it will add to the burden of the grassroots in Hong Kong. Yes, we're talking about 19% increase in salaries, and we're only increasing 10% of rentals. But let me ask you, how many of them will have that kind of increase? I think your sampling may result in a particularly high percentage for salaries or income increase. I think we believe that the entire mechanism should be completely overhauled. And in this year's amelioration measures in the policy address, the 2 months of rentals alleviation had not been followed through. It is but 1 month waiver, and we do not even know when that month's waiver will materialize. Some parties thought that it will be middle of the year, but that is not to be the case. And I got phone calls even today asking when will there be the 1 month waiver. And even with that, with the high inflation rate, it won't be helping much. Since it is that difficult already, would the HA consider, as in the past, that there should be a 1 month waiver to help our public housing residents in this very dire living conditions, to help them out to at least a certain extent? Mr. Chair, let me respond. According to the legislation, the rental adjustment mechanism had gone through several years of discussions. I think it was in 2001 that there was a committee set up specifically to look at the setting of rentals adjustments. Ms. Mack talked about inflation considerations. Yes, that's been discussed as well. But if we look at ordinary or general inflations and also changes in income levels, it would not reflect the tenants at public housing units, their income changes. Now, if I remember correctly, it was in 2006 that this mechanism was accepted, to the extent that for households living in public housing, well, to look at their income level changes. And yes, that is also the focus of our study as well. That is, their income level changes. The households living in these public housing areas, and taking away the outliers, the particularly high income earners, the wealthy households, etc. So, for and the CSSA recipients, so there is this validity to the mechanism. Ms. Mack pointed out just now that perhaps there can be certain comprehensive waiver for rentals. As I have mentioned in my introduction, the committee under the HA feels that under the legislation, since there is this cap of 10% for any rentals increase, and that is to say the 19-point-something percent is not increased to the full, if there is a cross-the-board waiver, it would not be appropriate, and therefore it should be pinpointed and focused. Mr. Chairman, concerning the one-month waiver, as mentioned by Ms. Mack, it would provide certain relief. However, because the base had already been raised, it is really not much help. And also, the base figure had been revised upwards by 10%, increased, that is. And in the future, if that is to be further increased, let me just tell you, in 1996-1997, I proposed the change or the amendment to the rentals bill. And because the base figure is being continually increased, and that was a reason why I proposed the amendment to the ordinance. And now we are treading old path again. The base figure is being continually increased, and that is certainly not good. And under such circumstance, I would support Ms. Mack in asking for the one-month rentals waiver. And further, with this new mechanism, well, it is really not ideal because you have not taken into account inflation. 2013, do you know what the real income rate was? It was negative 0.2%. That is, real income dropped. That is to say, income actually decreased because of inflation pressures. Have you thought about that? Have you considered that? You talked about sustainability or affordability. What is affordability? Do we not have to look at the standard of living? Under any circumstance, people can pay the rents because you just tighten the belt further by two holes. You'll be able to foot the bill for rentals. This is highly problematic not to include inflation considerations. So I urge that this ordinance be reconsidered to see how we can avoid lowering of standard of living. Because I can tell you that this is really, without the waiver, it is a 0%. There is 0% of lowering of rentals. Tell me when it can or will happen, Mr. Secretary. So I urge that we consider inflation rates as well. Secretary, Mr. Chairman, I have talked about the background to the design of the mechanism. According to the HA and the data collection and also the validation from the CNS commissioner, it is true that the income had risen for the household in the PRH. That is, with higher income, and it is a truth, it is a fact, with higher earning power, logically speaking, there should be more or higher affordability. As Mr. Lai had mentioned in the figures that he had quoted, if we use 2013 average household as an indicator, and also use the rentals at the time, and also put in an additional 10%, but mind you, actual real income had fallen by 0.2%. That also is a fact. Have you considered that, Leung Chee Hong? Mr. Chair, even though the rentals increase this time is in compliance with the mechanism and in 2007, it was 4.6% increase, 2012, 10%, 2014, another 10%. If we follow the existing mechanism, even though CPI and income level have risen, and therefore you have proposed the increase in rentals, but on the other hand, if we look at the figures, perhaps you have not considered certain aspects, for example, inflation. Inflation is not in balance with income increase. For this year, for instance, or last year, inflation was 4.6% overall, and basic inflation rate was 3.7%. And our salaries increase, one can say, had fallen short of these two figures. we listen to our community, they tell us that their income and salaries had not risen by that much. For the civil service, it is but 3.something%, less than 4% increase in salaries.
In other words, you want a 10% increase, meaning that according to your data, the grassroots have received a 10% increase in earning, in income. Your data don't seem to tally with what we have got in the community. Maybe there are some errors in your survey. Since it's not in line with the reality that we see, perhaps you should consider whether this is an accurate mechanism. That's why PRH tenants have come out to protest that the 10% rent increase is not reasonable. So, Secretary, is there any room for the further adjustment to the index? Are there inaccuracies? Can you make some adjustments, Secretary? Well, for statistics, I wonder if the Commissioner for Census and Statistics can offer us some advice. Commissioner, Mr. Tang, the Census and Statistics the Department is responsible for compiling the income index. According to our professional judgment, this is correct. The index is correct. We select every month 2,000 households for samplings, and then we also select 5% for a presentation of income proof. And it's been proved that declarations are correct, or the discrepancy is minimal. We have done a few things to make sure that the sample is representative. Time's up. Time is short. I won't allow you to continue. Mr. Lee Chuck-yan, why is it that the income has gone up to a greater extent? Because you're not looking at individuals, you're looking at households. If there are more breadwinners, more people working in the household, then the increase would be bigger. But you know that you have to pay for your expenses if you go out to work. These grassroots families would like to see their living standards improve. But if you increase their rent, that hope would be dashed. And it would also add to inflationary pressure. The PRH rent increase would go against the community's aspiration to care for the grassroots and to reduce poverty. So, Secretary, you are an enemy to the grassroots. After allowing the MTR to increase fares, now you want to increase PRH rent. And this goes to the necessities of the grassroots, and their living standard will see no improvement. You may argue that this is done in accordance with mechanism. The FTU is asking that you give a one-month waiver, although you are acting in accordance with the mechanism. The biggest problem with the FTU is that back in those years, they supported the rent review mechanism. If that mechanism was not endorsed, we wouldn't be seeing problems now. And now we have problems with rental increase. And then FTU now wants to offer a one-month waiver. Well, they should have opposed to the mechanism back then. We forewarned back then that there would be problems. And now we are discussing issues based on a mechanism which we endorsed. And all the points made were already made back then. If there's no change to the mechanism, then we are going to see rent increases every 2 years, unless there's a drop in income levels. But that's not what we want to see. Secretary, your proposed rent increase would mean that the grassroots families can expect no improvement in living standards. Would you agree that you should review the mechanism immediately? Before the Secretary replies, well, I'm a member of the FTU. I have with me the voting records. I have to clarify that the FTU voted against the mechanism. So please check the records carefully before you say this. Mr. Lee, I was not the secretary when the mechanism was endorsed. But from what we can do, what we can see, I'll give you some time because I spoke. But it's only reasonable that if the tenants have a higher income, that they should pay a higher rent. And even if we look at the rent as a percentage of income, even if we take into account the latest 10% increase, the rent would also account for a level lower than 10% of the household's income. So it cannot be said that the rent increase would affect the living standards of these tenants very much. Well, let me say that I would retract what I said about FTU before Mr. Frederick Fong speaks. I'd like to seek your agreement. We have many members who have indicated a desire to speak, and we have a motion to deal with. Would you agree that we can extend the meeting by 15 minutes? All right, can you stay for a little longer, Secretary? Well, so we will adjourn by 5:15 sharp. I think mechanism was endorsed at the very end of that particular legislative session, and then the cap was put at 10% for rent increase, and the mechanism would involve the ratio between income and rent. Before 1997, we thought that 10% would be reasonable. And that's a different thing from putting a cap on the rent increase at 10%. Back then, Mr. Li Chagan and I opposed to the mechanism. And now it seems that we are seeing higher and higher percentages of rent increase. If we look at the matter from the point of view of rent-to-income ratio, rent in the private market is very high. The rent-to-income ratio is as high as 30 or 40%. We would very much like to make sure that the public housing rent will not be going up so fast. If you apply the same formula, of course, we would challenge you. We say that the formula is no good. We can give you one reason or 10 reasons. So I think we should look at the basics. Would the secretary be willing to agree to us that we should look at the basics? Well, I have inherited this mechanism under the law. But the mechanism is not about comparing rent with income, but rather the rate of increase, which is capped at 10% every time. If we look back into to 2008, the rent was reduced by 11.6%, and then the two-year cycle would kick in, and the increase would be capped at 10%. Even though the mechanism does not involve looking at the rent-to-income ratio, but I have already provided you with some comparative information. If we look at the 2013 average income, $18,845, and if the average rent is $1,540, to be increased by 10% to $1,694, the average percentage is 9.18%. So if we take into account the average rent vis-a-vis average income, the rent-to-income wage ratio is 9.18%. Maybe that's the current situation, but I would like to also look at the policy. Would the Bureau be willing to look at the policy? Because theoretically, if the rent increase is capped at 10%, the rent-to-income ratio can go beyond 10%. Would you be willing to look at the policy again in view of past considerations? Rent in the private market is increasing so rapidly. We would like to see that some cooling effect be provided by the public rental housing rent. Mr. Winston Fang, I'm in favor of this government proposal. I think it's reasonable not to provide an across-the-board waiver. There are 3% of well-off tenants. If we provide across-the-board waiver, then even the well-off tenants will be benefited. I don't see any reason why well-off tenants should be given this benefit. As for CSSA households, tenants, their rent is paid by the government anyway. Rent increase means nothing to them. Only 2% of your tenants are receiving rent subsidy. That's on the low side. After increasing the rent, if your tenants have difficulties in paying, you should improve your rent subsidy scheme, make it easier for people for your tenants to qualify. I believe assistance should better be rendered in that way. I don't think there should be an across-the-board waiver. Whether it's reasonable to increase the increase rent by 10%? Well, actually, in the previous agenda item, Mr. Michael Tint mentioned that a bed space 3 feet by 7 feet would fetch a rent of $1,300 back then, and now it's $1,900. So the PLH rent is far below the private market rent. So if it's 10% as a ratio of rent to income, it's very reasonable. If only everyone in Hong Kong is paying that kind of rent as a ratio to their income, we'll have many, many more happy people in Hong Kong. So for those who are allocated PLH flats, they are very lucky. It's like winning a lottery. And the rent doesn't go up for these tenants every year. Now it's only the third rent reviewed a 10% increase is very reasonable. I'm in favor of the proposed treatment in the paper. There should be no across-the-board waiver. Well-off tenants should get no waiver. And we should do more to help those who need help under the rent assistance scheme. And the government should also do more publicity so that needy tenants will know when or how to seek assistance, because I suspect many of the tenants just don't know how to apply. At a meeting of the Subsidized Housing Committee of the HA, some members said that they were not in favor of providing an across-the-board waiver, but they also said that for those tenants in genuine need, the HA should consider providing better assistance to needy tenants. There should be a more focused approach to follow, and the department will follow up.
Mr. Chairman, I think the problem is this. The feeling felt by the tenants at the PRH is very different from that of the government, because the sampling households have a 13.1% to 21.2% range of increase. Now, I do not know about the sampling, whether the households sampled mostly with more members coming out, members of the household coming out to work, etc. But the feeling is basically very different. The PRH tenants do not feel that their income has increased by some 20%. We have to handle that kind of sentiments as well. And also, the Civic Party had also pointed out before that we are only considering income and not expenditure. As we know, expenditure is affected by inflation. So what is actually pocketed is not directly linked to income increase. So two issues here. One, sampling. On sampling, the households may not be totally representative. And secondly, on the mechanism itself, it does not link up or consider inflation and expenditure. And therefore, the sentiments among PRH tenants is that the figures or percentage you show is not the figure that they feel is right. So for rentals subsidy, perhaps we can consider that to help alleviate pressure. Mr. Wong Yun Fai had said that, the chairman had said that the rentals increase will be in place in September, and whether there can be relief for certain particularly needy households. I do not know whether there is sufficient time to do so. And for particularly needy households, how will you deal with them? Will you still nevertheless make it mandatory that they come up with the higher levels of rental in September? Mr. Chairman, first of all, in terms of sampling is representative. Mr. Leung talked about the sampling. Well, basically, we have households with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 members, and the sampling would be the 710,000 households. The one member family would be in proportion to the number of one-member family or households within the population of PRH. Now, labor shortage is really within the low-income earners. And there had been a lot of salaries increase among the lower-income members. And we also noticed that in the PRH households, a lot more of the members of the households are coming out to work, joining the workforce, because we see low-skilled labor are coming out to work, housewives, the retirees, etc. So, yes, the number of people in employment are higher from the households. Yes, Ms. Wong, please. Last Friday, the subsidized housing committee had its meeting. From subsidized housing to application qualifications, we will be looking at it again to see how we can optimize the scheme. And I can tell you the handling time is as fast as 2 weeks for handling such cases, needy cases. Mr. Chairman, we'll be looking at 2011 to 2013 average monthly household income. It is perhaps too general if we only look at that. As a census in Statistics Department had pointed out, there should be a number for each of the household, and we cannot see that here. And we should be able to see, but we don't see it here, whether the concentration is in smaller household or larger households. And 2013, as mentioned just now, because of the tight labor market, there had been an increase in income, and also minimum wage had also increased by, was also increased by 7%. As for the application income, minimum income, it had also increased. That is the application, the income for applying PRH. So we have to understand how these numbers come by. It's mentioned that the people in general at PRH do not feel that their salaries or income had increased by 10% every year. And with the minimum wage, there are more people coming out to work. In a sense, income had increased, but the point is to raise the standard of living. But if you increase rentals, because the income had risen, then you'll be criticized that the money had gone to the government, had gone to rentals, had gone to food, the basic necessities. Why can't we make living a bit easier for them with higher income? Because the PRH tenants are all low-income people. Why can't we provide some relief to them? Why do we have to be close in on them with higher rentals right away? Because PRH tenants are definitely not wealthy people. And we know that there are voices out there saying that for subdivided flats, rentals, their rentals are even higher, and they are even at even more dire situations. So there is actually allegations that PRH residents are actually better off than the subdivided flats tenants. So I would say if we have a general policy set in the future for those who are private housing tenants, that they will have the chance someday to go into PRH units. And for PRH unit tenants, that we provide them with the right measures to set the rentals so that this can also benefit the future residents who are at present in private housing. And also to really raise the standard of living rather than to see their income increase and then take away their increase by increasing the rentals. Yes, Mr. Chairman, yes, we have thought about a number of ways in setting the mechanism, whether we should take the mean or take the average or the median. Now, 10% as the cap. The average rentals after adding the 10% in terms it is still less than 10%. It is 9.18% in terms of household experiencing rental raise. As mentioned just now, we will be following the Housing Authorities Committee to provide more assistance to the needy households. Mr. Chair, I think the HA is not poor. The surplus is some 6 to 7 million. And if you say that with this adjustment of rentals, if it is a billion or more, it is really not a big number. Does the HA have such dire purpose to increase rentals? We do not see that. But as rent inflation is rampant, and with basic necessities, food, transport increasing in prices, and the HA being such a big landlord affecting some one-third of the population of Hong Kong being tenants of PRH units. In fact, it really does impact greatly on the livelihood of Hong Kong people. And an increase of 10% of rentals is certainly not a small number. So we would support a one-month rental waiver. As for subsidies for rentals, especially for low-income households, that is those under 50% on the queue. And I look at the numbers, the households are not that many. It is but 5% of the total of number of households. But of course, there are the aged and non-aged households. My question is, when will you adjust the subsidized rentals scheme? If you look at the queue, the income level is $4,800, and that is $4,800 being the cap for one person's income, and $7,400 for two people, $9,000 plus for three people, before you will waive 50% of the rentals. I would like to know when you will review that, and when will you include disabled or disability together with the aged, rather than to have a separate queue for the disabled in the non-aged sector? Yes. Based on the opinions raised at the Friday meeting, we will see how we can deepen and come up with better help. Well, Mr. Chair, actually, this is for short-term needy households' applications for this kind of subsidies and relief. If it is on the long-term basis, they should apply for CSSA. As for aged households, whether it is one person or an entire household made up of aged people, they will be eligible for 50% waiver of rentals. As for non-aged, it will depend on their income level, either 50% or 25% waiver. And we are talking about 2% of households applying for this. But really, how many there are depends on the needs of these PRH tenants. We are looking at reviewing the scheme so that in terms of threshold of application, whether we can lower that, etc., we are looking into it. But at the end of the day, it is a Housing Authority Rental Subsidy Committee which will be looking at it. Do you have a timetable? Well, they just had a meeting last Friday, and we have been asked to do this review, so we will do that as soon as possible. And what about the disabled? For the aged old people, you have a standard. Can you not make that at par with the disabled? Well, definitely in the review, we can look at this as well. Lee Kwok Lun. Mr. Chairman, I've heard the discussions concerning raising of rentals, and mostly the opinions are in objection to the mechanism. Yes, but this is legislated, this mechanism. Mr. Secretary, you have heard that our colleagues have never been in agreement to the mechanism in the past years, and we always maintained, or the colleagues always maintained, that other factors such as inflation should be taken into account. You come to the Let Show every time and you're being criticized. Do you have a roadmap? Do you have a timetable to amend the mechanism? But on the other hand, because we have a law, we have to follow it. Otherwise, we'll be criticized for not following the law. Perhaps in terms of changing the legislation, we have our deliberations, but whether you agree or not agree with it, we have to follow the law. So I'm in support of the document that is increasing the rentals. But you may have to come up with a timetable for the review of the mechanism, and that is a political consideration. On another issue concerning the PRH, I see that 57% of tenants are paying $100 to $200. According to your calculation, their household income would be between $10,000 to $20,000 to make that 10%. So is this acceptable? Of course, those on the receiving end would not be happy. 57% of the people are having a $100 or about that of rentals increase. Now, if you cast a net wider for rental subsidy, given $10,000 income, perhaps they should be extended that assistance as well. I do not know whether Ms. Wong, you said that there will be a review, whether you can extend this to them.
Well, I'm not in favor of dealing with the emotions related to the mechanism, because the figures are there. And also, if you go along with some members' suggestions to provide a 1 month waiver, what would happen to your financial position? According to some members, you are in a healthy financial position. Oh, I'm open-minded about that. But if that means that you are going to suffer from a shortage of funds, then I'm not going to be supportive. As Dr. Lee has said, we have made the calculations. The proposed increase is capped at 10%. Although the income went up by 19%, but according to the law, the rent increase is capped at 10%. If we look at the average income, household income, and the average rent to income level is 9%. So is it not affordable? One cannot say that it's not affordable. Well, any rent adjustment is going to be controversial. Of course, it's best that you don't increase rent. There have been a lot of arguments before we came up with this formula. Well, it's difficult to get a formula that is not controversial. The best way to deal with those who cannot afford to pay would be to do it through the rent subsidy scheme instead of trying to get a new formula. All right, I think the speaking time for members is up. I would like to say that I find it regrettable that the HA proposes to increase rent by 10% because no consideration has been taken about inflation, and that the ordinary employees, normal employees, are not getting the income or wage increases to catch up with inflation. So instead of 10%, why can't you increase the rent by a level lower than inflation or just up to inflation? You don't have to increase it by the maximum permissible extent, i.e. 10%. So I cannot accept the HA's decision to increase rent by 10%. Why can't you consider a lower level, for example, a level on par with inflation or lower than inflation, although the ordinance allows you to do this? But ordinary employees don't get wage increase as much as 10%. And the administration is also contradicting itself. You have an assistance scheme. You are also proposing a relief measure to provide 1 month's rent. But it seems that the HA is giving people an impression that they are doing you a good turn this time, but very soon they are going to increase your burden very quickly. I think there is room for conducting a review and improving the mechanism on rent review. We voted against the mechanism. We are of the view that the mechanism should be reviewed. I clarified the FTU stance, and Mr. Li Qiaoyan retracted what he has said concerning the stance of the FTU when the mechanism was proposed for endorsement. Now we are seeing the increases for different areas. If rent is going to go up again, the standard of living of PRH tenants will be affected. There's no time, so I don't want a response. Chairman, I want to clarify a point. We compare the changes within the 2 year period. If the change is more than 0.1%, then a rent increase is mandatory, and there's a cap. For this time, the income has gone up by 19%, and the rent increase proposed is just 10%. The HA is not authorized to do something different. I think it's a matter of perspective. I don't think I subscribe to your views entirely, but it doesn't matter. It's time to deal with Ms. Alice Mack's motion. My motion is that since the HA has proposed a 10% rent increase for TIH tenants to ease their burden, this panel would like the administration at the HA to follow past practice and provide 1 month's rent waiver and to review the mechanism ASAP. Would those in favor please raise your hands? 6 are in favor. Those against? Abstentions? 1 abstained. The motion is carried. And that wraps up the particular agenda item. Thank you for your attendance, government officials. Members, please stay on. We have another item. It's paper 1, CB1, 1705, 1314. It's a report of the Subcommittee on the Long-Term Housing Strategy. And this is a report, and the panel will be reviewing this in due course. There's nothing under AOB, so meeting's adjourned. Thank you all for your attendance.